Thank you. Welcome to I Just Met You, and This Is Crazy, But Here's My NaN, Call Me Maybe. This is a play on a song from the United States, and I'm never going to think of a great title for a talk like this again in my life. That's my one. So this is the talk where I get to come here and make fun of JavaScript in front of people. I normally just make fun of JavaScript by myself, but now I get to give a talk about it. There's certainly plenty of material. So what makes JavaScript so fun? All of it. There's many, many things that JavaScript does that other languages do, but JavaScript just makes it a little bit just stupid. Stupid. We'll see some of that. And it's bad enough that I can find programmers who will write C# pretty dumb. JavaScript just makes it easier to write dumb code. So we'll see some of these. This sums up the talk. The good parts of JavaScript. Yeah. So JavaScript, it's not Java. Anybody unclear about this? It's not Java, but often folks come up to me at other conferences, usually the young folks, and they'll say, I'm working in Java, and look at this code. And I say, it's JavaScript. And they say, it's the same thing. How long have you been programming? Oh, 6 hours. Oh, okay, so it's not Java. Java is to JavaScript as car is to carpet. It's not Java. Java is, anybody eat hamsters? I'm guessing they're not very tasty. I'm not sure what I ate the other night at the dinner, but I think it was not a hamster. Don't eat hamsters here either. Java is to JavaScript as ham is to hamster. So it's not Java, not even close to Java. But it has the name Java in it. So that's the first thing. Its name tells you a lot, that it's just not right. How about this? Who's on the left? Which kind of programmer are you? So some things that JavaScript does. JavaScript tries to be a helpful language, and it allows us to have enough rope that we can go and hang ourselves. And it does this with things like allowing us to not put in a semicolon, or it will do a statement termination for us automatically. Well, as a programmer, if you're going to be a good programmer, we need to have syntactically correct code. Except JavaScript doesn't actually care if you have syntactically correct code. But Java does, but not JavaScript, because Java is ham, and JavaScript is a hamster. It kind of is like a hamster. So all the things here on the slide that JavaScript allows us to do, did you know you can put a, or you can forget the front bracket and then put an ending one on, it'll actually let you do that. However, most parsers will catch that nowadays, but the language itself doesn't care. How dumb is that? Who thought that up? Not me. Things like break, continue, return, and throw, it also does some automatic syntax checking for us. As a programmer, though, we want to make sure that we still, again, have syntactically correct code. If for no other reason if you let JavaScript do these things, can you imagine what the other person who's looking at your code next thinks? They're like, who wrote this? Oh, that was me. Becca, how's this one? Yeah, so in JavaScript, semicolons, sometimes, semicolons, maybe not. It lets you do both. Something we can do in JavaScript is this. We can have an expression, such as if okay, or if true, or some condition, and then run a line of code. And many developers, again, forget about the curly brackets, because JavaScript will insert them for us, and they write code like that, like the second piece here. So devs write this kind of code. But that's no good. It looks like that to the developer, but to JavaScript, it puts the brackets in, or it looks like that to the parser. So it will automatically insert the curly brackets and semicolons. And what it might look like to one developer, it looks different to the parser. That's no good. Also, the next developer to see your code is sitting there going, what the heck? Who does that? This is what happens when you do that. Has this happened today to anybody? This has already happened to me today. Like every day. How about functions? Functions in JavaScript are a first-class construct. Functions behave as we expect functions to behave, to run a snip of code and possibly return a value. However, functions also behave as an object. And we can also nest functions. Because C# will let you do that, right? Never. Not many programming languages do. Some of the more functional ones will. Something else that functions will do, or behave differently depending on how we construct them. We have two kinds, basically. One's called a function statement, and the other a function expression. The function statement behaves like a plain old function in other languages, where we would declare the function and then call it whenever. The parser will load the function ahead of time, so we're free to call it whenever we want. However, the bottom piece of code, the function expression, this one here can give us a little bit of a problem. If I try to call that function expression before it is declared, it will give me an error. So this is what happens. This first piece of code will work, even though the declaration is here and the call is here. However, what is supposed to be a function, the declaration is here, but this will bomb. All right, so that won't work. So we have to call the function expression after it's declared. Anyone new to JavaScript here? So we know it's not Java, and we know it's not a hamster. But this very much trips up novices and folks that are seasoned programmers, but from other languages. Many other languages, you must declare the function and call it in a particular manner. JavaScript's like, I don't care. Well, except here. Whoops. Something else we can do with functions is create what's called an anonymous function or an immediately invoked function expression the IIFE. Those are, they're kind of handy. You, if you've used jQuery, you've seen this. That's what jQuery does. It's the ready function. And what this does is it puts a wrapper around code so that we can drop the code, wrap the code, and it executes right there in line. So that's kind of nice. And I can even embed these in other functions or nest them. So with functions, we want to take a quick look. I have a function statement. This will run. It is declared at line 7, but called at line 4. The function expression, however, that's not going to work. So if I browse this, it should bomb, and it did bomb. And if I bring up the debugger, I can see that that's right where it bombed eventually when the debugger pops up. There we go. So it has no idea what I am talking about. I have no idea what I am talking about. But I did stay at a Holiday Inn Express last night. I don't believe anybody actually got that joke. So if I move my call to the function expression, now it should work. Or not. Heck was that about? Did I miss something stupid? Probably. Okay. Did I miss something else? Oh, caching, that's right. Yeah, stupid IE. That's another whole half of a day of complaining around IE. Yeah, that is caching, that's right. Okay. There we go. All right, so all of them run. Right. And the anonymous function down at the bottom just runs in line. How about that? Yeah. This is most of JavaScript. JavaScript. Arrays in JavaScript. Did you know there are none? Technically, we make things that we call arrays, but to JavaScript, it's just a data construct. So technically, there are no dimensions, and you will not get a proper out-of-bounds error. You will get an undefined, but that is not the same. That's not a proper out-of-bounds error, because there are no bounds. It's JavaScript. It lets you do whatever you want, as we're seeing is probably not a good idea, but it does. So with arrays, if we do a type of, it doesn't necessarily know the difference. Here's another piece that I like. Who uses the continue? Well, who will now admit to it? This is my favorite quote, because I agree. I've never seen a piece of code that was not improved by removing the continue statement. If we have a loop, isn't the point to loop? Right? So telling it to continue, well, it's already looping. It's already continuing. We don't need to do that. Generally, if we are doing things like that, we probably are breaking out of a loop or not allowing the loop to run naturally like it should. And that's why the code is improved when you get rid of the continue statement. Here's more fun. This causes a lot of angst and problems. As developers, we're constantly comparing, and we need to do this with operators, operands, and expressions. As far as the operands go, we have, instead of just true and false, like other normal languages, we have these truthy and falsy kind of values. So false is actually true, if we put single quotes around it. So to JavaScript, it sees that as true. It also sees that as true, because it's truthy. So it could be true, sometimes, maybe. And on the other side, zero, at least, is always false. We can rely on zero, good old zero. Also, other things that are falsy, null. Right, null means we don't have a value, or null should mean we don't have a value. But in JavaScript, it's like, hey, we have a value, but we don't know what it is. Or we might not have a value. NaN is also a falsy value as well. So if we look at some truthy and falsy code, JavaScript. I have an HTML table simply that lists each one of these expressions of truthy and falsy, and we can see what they look like when I run it. Here in my ready function, I'm going to compare all of these false to false, and we're going to see what the results are. So let's run this and take a look. So false equal false, that's false, because false is true. Yeah, false equals zero is true, because zero is, that doesn't look right. None of this looks right. Down at the bottom here. So here's some things that happen with this and why this happens. A little bit weird, isn't it? A little bit, a lot weird, here's why. These. Very simple. Evil, not evil. Okay? So, as a rule of thumb, use the constructs over there on the right, your right. Right? Derecha is right. See? Izquierda is left. See? I'm doing good. What these are called are the abstract equals and the exactly equals. Aha, exactly equals. Abstract? No. Why does it work this way? The abstract equals, the double equals, has to convert, or it tries to convert the values on both sides, and sometimes it does. And then it says, oh, I will convert and compare. Well, when you convert, it's not a true comparison. In computer science, we frown upon that kind of thing. So the exactly equals, if it sees that the data types are different, false. How it should be. It's how other languages that are statically and strongly typed work. We saw that. Here's another one. This is going to be weird because it's the word this, which is weird in English. It's probably twice as weird in Spanish, right? So this is a problem everywhere. We have a notion of this in statically typed languages, and it's easy in C sharp. In VB, they call it me. How cute. But this, it's called this in JavaScript, I believe this in Python, this in many languages. The problem with this in JavaScript is that this changes as the code runs. In C#, or VB, VB's me, me or this, is always referring to the current instance of that object. That's easy. In JavaScript, this could be some element or a button or anything. It's usually the, how I say, the closest object. So if somebody clicked a button, the button is this. But if that button calls code that maybe loops through something, this can be different. So with this, here I have some basic HTML, a button, and an unordered list. Oops, right here, an unordered list. And in it, I'm going to click the button and see what this is. Now, in the beginning, this will be the button. And before the button, or outside of the scope of the button, this could be the window object, right? The global scope. After that, I can, and this makes it better, I'm sure this is great in Spanish, right? That equals this. You might see this, we do var self equal this, and this is why we might see this pattern in development. So this will be the button. But then, later on, if I decide to loop through that unordered list, as I each through it, this is going to be each of those list items. So it changes. So when I run, we'll see that. So when I click the button, anything that, as it becomes this, it will turn red. So the button was this. And then all of the items are this. This is a lot easier in C sharp. All right, just this is the object we're in. JavaScript, this is very fluid. This is that. This is something. This is whatever. It's anything but this. So this is very interesting. You can also make this be what you want. This is. Now, this is weird when you get to this one. If I have some code, let's see, another unordered list, right? Nothing in it, but what I'm going to do is have some code that comes in here and just has a little say something function. And I'm going to call this say something function, and I'm going to pass in something to say. But notice, I'm only passing in one argument. However, I can still get to this. And I can get to it by passing in two arguments. I declare one argument, but I can pass in two. First of all, who does that? Declare two arguments if you're going to pass two arguments? So I can just stick this in the beginning, and that's because of another thing JavaScript does. Optional arguments. Normally, most languages, not all, there's one or two that do it this way also. Most optional arguments go at the end. No, not in JavaScript. They go in the beginning. Just to mess everyone up, right? They made JavaScript and they said, let's have some fun. We'll do that. So that's what this, and I can actually do this notation by using the dot call. You have to use that to pull this little trick off. I would not suggest to actually pull this trick off. The maintenance programmer is going to hate you a lot. They may even attack you after work for that kind of code. But that's what this will do. I can actually force this to be whatever I need it to be. So it can start out being the window, it can be a programmer, it could be whatever I want this to be. This is a lot easier in any other language. It just doesn't do weird things like that. Here's another one. eval, that's just bad. We're done. I see code like the top line when folks don't realize that you can just put things together in a dynamic way, because that's how JavaScript works. Eval is necessary once in a while when we have a good reason for it. Most of the time, though, not so much. It's a kind of a big, fat security hole. And IT pros tend to frown upon that when we leave big, fat security holes in our code. Here's it. Who knew that there was such a thing as with in JavaScript? And you admit that? Because again, VB does that. Does anybody actually write code with the with? No, okay. Or you just won't admit to it. You can do it. Should you do it? No. It's there. Actually, if you do this in VB, it could be an actual performance enhancement. Not that I ever wrote VB code, that I will admit to. In JavaScript, however, not so much. JavaScript, because it's parsed, has to do a little bit more. It doesn't turn out the way it should. Also, a lot of folks don't know about it, and they look at the code and go, what's going on here? Again, the maintenance person is probably not going to like you. Parsing. This is not too bad, but we have the parse int, parsing. We could take a string, and it gives us back an int. Okay. When we do that, there's one of two choices. There's with the base, or without. As a rule of thumb, it's a little better to use option two. First, it is more clear of code. Number two, depending on what operating system you're using or what other things you're running, you could run into some problems with the bases. It does default to 10, it tries to, a base 10. But sometimes you could run into some weird stuff, and it'll let you do weird stuff. For example, I can parse all of these and I will get a number. I should probably not get a number when I try to parse P. Shouldn't give me a number, but it does. A lot of these things will parse out, and instead of giving me the number that I expect, it will give me something else or something weird, or sometimes it will give me not a number. But we're gonna see that's actually a number. So parseInt can trip us up sometimes if we're doing some strange things. It's just easier if we use it with both arguments. Everybody's favorite, outside of undefined. That's everybody's real favorite, undefined, not a number. You know, not a number is a number, except it's not a number. It says it's not a number, but it is a lying piece of crap. If I try to use an equality operator, I'll go into my F12 tools, and I will do, use NaN. Hello. All right, so that's actually right. So when I run isNaN, the isNaN function is not a number. So it's saying, is not a number 9? Well, 9 is a number, so it's false. So when it says, is not a number, 9 is a number. That doesn't make any sense, but it does. So is NaN. If I need to compare things, I would not want to actually use plain old isNaN like this. I can get a lot of weird stuff. I can do that. Is not a number, A. I can also do things, actually more of an appropriate thing to do is to use type of to see what type something is. If I run isNaN gives me incorrect results because NaN has no idea what it actually is. It says it's not a number, but it's a number, but sometimes it's not a number. It has a severe identity crisis. No good. So if we use type of, hey, it's a number. It actually says a number. That's a little better than trying isNaN. Now in ECMAScript 6, finally, only, what, 25 years later, they decided to fix it. So in ES6, it'll be okay. However, ECMAScript 6 is what, another 10 years? Right? So type of. Plain old isNaN has no idea what it's talking about. So do type of or wait for ES6. Don't hold your breath. Another thing you could use to kind of avoid this is TypeScript instead. Here's something else. Look at this code at the top and bottom. Something's wrong. It's legal. You can do that. Who's going to admit to doing this? No. You do this when you're ready to quit your job, just like some of the other code. You can do it, doesn't mean you should do it. So all of these nonsensical things that are in JavaScript, Visual Studio doesn't exactly help us with, does it? Visual Studio says, yay, IntelliSense, all these tools. But you could still write really shitty JavaScript. So some of the tools to help not write stupid code and not piss off your coworkers is JSLint. By the guy who wrote that book, The Good Parts, he made JSLint. And what a linter is it's basically a way to go through code and fix it because it's broken. And in this case, it's JavaScript. All the odd things from JavaScript. You put your code in a linter and it runs through and tells you what kind of crazy things you've been doing with the code. When Douglas Crockford made JSLint, he made it so tight and it picks up so many of these problems that nobody wants to actually use it because they keep getting errors. So JSHint exists. That's like JSLint Lite. It's like a diet, JSLint. So that will only yell at you a little bit. JSLint yells at you a lot. JSHint, only a little. And the last piece is JSFiddle, which just lets you play. It's a playground for JavaScript. All three of these are online. There we go. So I can go to JSFiddle, JSLint, or JSHint. Come on, internet. Donald Belcham and I have been breaking things all day. We probably broke the internet too. Yeah. So here I can copy and paste code into JSFiddle. I can then run the code, anything that you need to do. HTML as well, all of the bad code you can run. And JSFiddle has a link to JSHint. So you can actually paste your code in here and have it scrub through and pick out any of those problems. If you're using isNaN, or watch out, this is changing, or any of these kind of issues that we might have. And that's all I have, right? There's plenty more of JavaScript, right? That whole big book, the rest of that is the rest of the crazy from JavaScript. But we have the little book, the good parts, to help us write the good code in JavaScript. And that's what I have for today. So thank you.